Before beginning this video, I want to show you these two longhorn beetles that I found. These beetles were attracted to a light that I set out about an hour ago. This species is Orthomegas marechali, and that genus represents some of the larger longhorn beetles that we have out here. What I want you to take a look at is these mandibles that they have. They have quite an interesting shape. See, normally longhorn beetles have straight mandibles, but you can see that this species' mandibles are curved upwards like tusks. Like I said before, these are Orthomegas marechali, and I know that there's at least one other species in this genus, Orthomegas monai, that also has these tusk-like mandibles. So it's not just this one. And other species in this genus, like Orthomegas cinnamomeus, have very normal-looking mandibles, and then you have species like Orthomegas pelki that have very long mandibles compared to this one. And unlike a lot of the larger beetles out here, these tend to be more reliable during the dry season. Tonight we will be looking for the Costa Rican vinegaroon. Vinegaroons are a group of arachnids that are largely terrestrial, and they spray an acid out of their butt that smells a lot like vinegar, which is what gives them their name. And the one that we are looking for is not very common at all, quite an elusive species, so I don't imagine that we will be finding many of them. Down here in the leaf litter, we have an Oophaga granulifera. That is this little frog right here, commonly referred to as the granulated poison dart frog. I want to show you that this one is in the only area around me that is wet on the surface. Meanwhile, in other areas around me, it's just dry leaf litter. This frog that we have here is one of four species of poison dart frogs that lives in Costa Rica, and one of only two in this genus that are found in Costa Rica. The other species, of course, is the strawberry poison dart frog, Oophaga pumilio, and that species has a much wider distribution in Central America than this one does. This one is a regional endemic. It lives almost exclusively on the South Pacific side of Costa Rica, as well as a small part of Panama. But there are also a couple of isolated populations on the Atlantic side. You can tell that this species is quite bumpy, especially on the dorsum, and that's where its second name, granulifera, comes from. As you might imagine, it translates to granulated. We have a Mayan lichen mantis sitting on this tree down here, and this individual is a final instar. This species, Liturgusa maya, has quite an extensive distribution. It's found throughout much of southern Mexico, as well as all Central American countries, and throughout much of northwestern South America. And this large range is probably due, in part, to their ability to colonize new areas. For example, this species is not native to the United States, but it has been introduced to southern Florida in a couple areas. Now, this mantis that we found was facing upwards, and that is because I spooked it right before I started filming. But you almost always find these facing downward. These mantises are waiting for small insects to be crossing up trunks. You can see that this mantis periodically throws its raptorial front legs forward. I'm not too sure what causes its behavior, but I do know, since I found this species quite a few times in the past, that sometimes you can get a reaction out of them if you poke them, and they'll punch you. Lastly, like many animals, from population to population, these mantises vary quite a bit. But what's also interesting is that, depending on the trees that they develop on, and the extent and color of the lichen covering them, mantises within the same population can develop different patterns in coloration. Just found this Valeriophonus nara juvenile. This is a Costa Rican vinegaroon. And I found this one underneath this log here. Vinegaroons in Costa Rica are a fairly easy group to learn. There's only one species found in the country, which is the one that we're looking at right now, of course. And on top of that, this genus is monotypic, which means that this is the only species in it. And lastly, this species is not recorded from outside of this country. But there's a very good possibility that it can be found in Panama as well. Currently, this species is only recorded from the greater South Pacific side of Costa Rica. These are relatively uncommon, especially when compared to the tailless whip scorpions that you can find out here. This is only the second one that I've ever seen. But to find them, you really have to be looking on the ground or under ground cover. These are highly terrestrial. Meanwhile, those tailless whip scorpions are frequently found on tree trunks, rocks, and large embankments. You can see that there's red coloration in this juvenile that will disappear as this vinegaroon grows in size. These are also nocturnal, but they don't come up above the ground very often. Like many vinegaroons, these can do a lot of their hunting underground. Finding that juvenile vinegaroon was basically only a fluke. I only flip stuff at night sometimes when it's more convenient and there's things nearby my feet. But if I wanted to turn logs to find vinegaroons, I would have just made a daytime video. So now I'm actually going to try to find one out in the open, because it really should be possible with this weather. I've never seen this phenomenon before in my life. We have a cut log here sitting on the ground. You'll notice a few termites walking around, nothing crazy. But over here on this end, almost the whole surface is covered in little termites. And these are the little termites that build their nests in trees, but consume wood that's laying on the floor or standing. And there's a good chance that these termites are hanging out in this log as well, which is why they're here, but I have no idea why they would be on the surface like this. Usually when these termites are moving from one place to another, it's in these little tunnels that they build on the surface to those nests that I was talking about, and you rarely ever see them exposed. In fact, nearly every time I've ever seen these termites in the wild was when I accidentally broke one of those tunnels. And what's especially peculiar about this, besides the fact that a lot of them seem to be doing nothing, is that they're not only congregating on the log, but also on nearby leaves. And just so that I'm not leaving you without an explanation as to what's going on, at the time of this being uploaded, there should be an explanation in the description. We have a sleeping anole up on this branch here. Unfortunately, I'm going to wake it up. This anole that we have here is called Anolis capito, or otherwise commonly known as the pug-nosed anole. This is a fairly widespread species of anole. It lives in the forests of southern Mexico and throughout Central America. The forests that they inhabit are typically quite humid, lowland, or moderate elevation. This species of lizard is quite a variable one too. You can see that this one's quite blotchy, but a lot of the ones I see sleeping around here on branches are quite plain colored with a couple stripes on their back. And in addition to this variability, they can change color to some degree as well. A lot of anoles have this capability. Compared to a lot of anole species out here, this one is quite large. From snout to vent, they can attain a length of almost 10 centimeters. This is something that caught me a little bit by surprise the first time I saw one. I couldn't start recording in time, but a small fossorial snake slipped into these leaves right here. In fact, you can see some of the scales right there. This little snake that we have here is commonly referred to as the red earth centipede snake, and this one that we have here is an adult. Centipede snakes are in the genus Tantilla, and this one is Tantilla schistosa. As the genus name suggests, these do feed primarily on centipedes. Along with their prey of choice, these snakes are not something that you see active on the surface very often, much less when it isn't raining very often. So they have quite a fossorial lifestyle, usually hanging out in rotting logs or underneath layers of leaf litter. This is primarily a lowland species that inhabits humid rainforests. More specifically, these seem to have a preference for primary forests. And though they tend to be elusive, they do have a relatively large range, extending from southern Mexico throughout Central America. Definitely easy to get distracted out here. While that juvenile vinegaroon did have some red coloration on it, the adults are generally just one color. And they're kind of tough to spot on the forest floor because they don't move too much. But I keep looking up in trees to see if I can find bycatch, despite the fact that I should really only be scanning the ground if I want to see one. But the tricky thing is, what we're looking for is practically the same color as all these shadows that the leaves make. Down here in the leaves, we have a mating pair of stick insects, and I'm going to try not to disturb them too much, otherwise they might disconnect. These two stick insects are in the genus Rhynchacris, but I'm not really sure on the species. Something tells me that these might be a little difficult to key out. And this is a genus that extends throughout Central America and in part of Colombia. And I've actually been seeing quite a few of these, and I have been meaning to film one, but it was the fact that I came across this mating pair that finally made me stop and film this species. Between all the ones that I've been seeing, practically all of them have been on the ground, so this species might have terrestrial tendencies, but it is hard to say because most of what I've seen has been adults, and they might just be looking for mates. And of course, as it often goes, you can tell that the male is quite a bit smaller than the female here. And not only that, but they have a generally different appearance. Sexual dimorphism in stick insects is really quite common. By the way, next to this mating pair right here, we might have another individual of the same species, this time a juvenile. And if this is indeed the same species, it has quite a ways to go. This one's quite small compared to that female that we saw. We have found ourselves an adult Costa Rican vinegaroon. This one right down here. And of course, I would like to see if this one is going to spray me. Nope. Maybe not. Although it almost seemed like it had the reflex. So I'm calling this vinegaroon an adult. And what I mean by that is this one is sexually mature. But if you are wondering, this one does have the ability to get a little bit larger than this. Also, if you were wondering, this individual is a male. Males tend to have larger boxing gloves than females do, and a prosoma that is more proportional to the abdomen, as is the case with some other arachnids. In looking at these boxing gloves, or the pedipalps, you'll see that much like scorpions, these have a fixed and movable finger, and this is almost exclusively for prey. They don't use these very often to defend themselves, but they do also use them to hold onto mates. I apologize for not being able to show the vinegar spray from this species. I was saying that I've seen this one before, and they have been able to elicit that reaction from the species before, so it's kind of unfortunate that we're not seeing that tonight, but I'll try to make it up to you and include it in a future video. We have quite a large katydid over here, sitting on this leaf. This genus has one of the craziest ratios of juveniles to adults that I've ever seen. No exaggeration, I see about 10 of these every night, but they're all first to second instar, which is really quite puzzling. And I'll admit, I don't even know the species. This is some kind of katydid in the genus Pristonotus, which is one that I'm not super well versed in, but have known for quite some while that they can get quite large like this one here. In fact, with a few others, this genus represents some of the largest species in Costa Rica, but they also live in Panama, Nicaragua, and the coastal mountains of northwestern Colombia. This genus is found in a range of habitat. Right now we're in fairly low elevation rainforest, but the moment that I first learned about these is when I saw a pinned adult from a cloud forest. While it's already quite difficult to find these adults at night, as you can probably imagine, since these are nocturnal, finding them during the day is even more difficult. Much like stick insects, when these are resting or disturbed, they tuck their legs in, and they're often on the sides of branches and vines, so their profile is concealed. Not much is known about the ecology of this genus, but it is known that these are omnivorous, feeding mostly on insects, leaves, and fruits. Well, as I mentioned, this species is not the easiest thing to spot, and the ones that we saw are two-thirds of the ones that I've ever seen in my life. So I'm going to cut it here. That is all for this video. Thank you for watching.